Hi, my name is Monty Rowland. I'm with Simply Us Farm, and today I wanted to carry you around the farm for a state of the farm tour. Try to do this every so often and share where we are and what we think we're going and kind of go from there. I lost the tripod that I hold the camera with, so hopefully this works out. Not sure what I did with that. We'll go for it anyway. So let's start out in the food forest area. I have tried to encourage clover. We've sown clover. So where we have a stand of clover, the bees love it. It's good for the soil. So we try to leave that. We are in the process of getting cages, our trellis up for the goji berry and the raspberry. We'll come back to that hopefully. So here's the blackberries. This is the first one. We've started putting in mulch around them. And we've had this blackberry down here is not come back yet. So maybe it won't. We also had a mulberry tree that was mauled by a deer. So I don't think it's coming back. The figs took a lot of damage this in February. We had a cold snap. After everything started coming back to life, so because it was so warm. And then all of a sudden we have this cold snap and these figs took a lot of damage. There's a ladybug. But they're coming back now. Just hoping to have a little more of a crop off these this year, but that cold snap, I don't think it's gonna happen. That's okay though. So our farm really isn't a production farm. We share what we grow with another family that helps us out, but we want to grow enough to where it makes it worthwhile for them. So there's another mulberry tree that's doing well. We've learned with mulberry trees to keep a cage around them. Elderberries love it here. Elderberries just thrive here. So one of the things that we're starting to get to is we've kind of thrown stuff in piles as we found it, this trash. And so now one of our next steps is to start cleaning that up. Got it segregated into several piles. We need to start hauling that off. One of our new additions is the olive tree. So this came from Rabbit Ridge Farm. So it seems to be doing well. And actually I see a little bitty olive down there. It's right there. We'll see how that goes. We put another olive tree in over here a few weeks ago. Don't know how the olives will do here. Let's take a look at another fig. These are all brown turkey. Look down here at the base. This fig is coming back to life. So it took a lot of damage from the cold snap. It got warm, it got warm, it got warm, and boom. One of the things we are trying to work out is our schedule to weed eat. Weed eating takes a lot of time. And so that's one of the things that's a labor thing that I'm trying to figure out how to make it happen. Connie left this bush so that I wouldn't hit the guy wire with a zero turn. Probably smart. Power pole. Another elderberry that's growing. We trim these in the fall. Now they're coming back strong. This fig is actually adding leaves to some of the branches. So they're coming back. You'll see some of our, well, and let me go back here. So you probably see this blue thing. So this is our reservoir of dirt. We bought some dirt from Brooks Contractor, which is a great vendor for us. And so what we did is we've been drawing from this. We bought a whole truckload and we've been using this for years. And so we use this as needed. At this point, it's not biologically active, but it does have nutrients in it. So we mix it with soil that's here and we draw from it. You can see what we've been drawing from here. We used this when we originally planted. Here's another fig that is starting to come to life. So we're still working through the weed eating part. if you have a homestead or a farm, maintenance is such a big issue. So in this case, we loaded this by hand, or the wood chips, you see. Wood chips were free, but we had to put a lot of effort into it to get them here. Front end loader would be awfully nice here. So here's our blackberries. These are thornless, and we trim these pretty heavily. So we are hoping that that will work out. Seen a lot of different advice on pruning thornless blackberries, and there's different types of canes with blackberries, and we're still learning there. So we had some raspberries that didn't make it. So I have a stick now. Here's a different type of blackberry that is starting to bush out. More blackberries, different type. He's coming back. All different, these types have different speeds. Now at our home in Sanford, it's just slightly warmer, even though it's only 30 minutes between the farm and the house. And it's funny, stuff at home has come out a lot earlier than here. But you can see the elderberry are getting ready to flower. Looking forward to having a nice elderberry crop. Some more flowers here. Elderberries are super easy to grow. Here's another case where the blackberry took some cold damage. You see down here this scale, I believe this is cold damage. It sure looks like it. It's scaly down here, but we're getting new canes coming up here. Don't think we're gonna get any fruit off these canes, but we'll have to see. So you can see over here, we've got more elderberry. I also want to point out these elderberry, you can see these green stalks. They are taking off. Figs are coming back to life after the cold damage. And blackberry. Here's another blackberry that's coming back very nicely. No flowers yet. Now on our hugel mound, back here, since I mentioned the blackberry flowers, let's come back here for just a second. You can see these blackberries are flowering very happily. So in the hugel mound, instead of growing winter squash, we changed directions here. And it's time to do a little weeding. So what we did is we bought blueberries from Finch. And we bought several different kinds and alternated. So you'll see in this video, you may notice different stages of development. Some of these need more chilling hours than others. And so you can see here, we're putting our hugel mound to a different use. We didn't have enough cages, so we figured we would put cages until we ran out, see what happened. So you can see this silver tag here. We tag all our perennials here, and each one has a number. So this is number 124. So we do that so that we can track when it was installed and when it and other information about it. So then this is a goji berry. Here's another goji berry. So the next step here is to put a trellis. You probably saw a piece of cattle panel. Then another thing new for this year, another thing we did is we tried using some boards for some different uses, like holding down silage tarps, and now we just got boards, we gotta move out of the way. And they were old and rotting, and they came with the property, so we tried to put them to good use, but it's been a challenge. So then, you can probably hear the buzzing. I'm not gonna get any closer, but we have bees this year. Thanks to Blue Truck, they have provided bees on the farm. So you'll be able to get honey from us, hopefully in a month or so, month and a half, somewhere in there. And maybe mid-June, late June. And that's something new, which is, I think, is really cool. Here are the bees on the farm. Really appreciate Scott for bringing bees out here. It's a huge blessing for our farm. Should have honey to sell here in a month and a half or so. Reasons we did that for several things. One is for pollination purposes. This helps us have a way to pollinate at an accelerated rate all our different plants. The other thing that does is we compare that with the elderberry. So in this case, when these elderberry fruit, we'll be able to pair elderberries with the bees to help pollinate them. So I think that'll be something that's hard to find, that most people can't provide, but that's something that we're gonna see how it works. I'm gonna stop here for a second and we'll walk and look at some other things. One of the things I'm very fond of is irises. We have several different irises. Now they are past their prime. So there's pictures on the website though you can see. And we also planted these. These are pretty cool from the bottom. So these really don't have a food value or medicinal value. It's just that I like irises. We also have a black iris right here, which hasn't produced any flowers yet. We'll just have to see. So one of the things you'll see is this pile of fertilizer. So there's a pile of fertilizer right here, and this pile of fertilizer has probably been the same in every video you've seen. I don't put it inside the shelter because I don't want it to go after the metal. We haven't used it. We've used very little fertilizer. We've used hay. We're adding some wood chips this year. We've used some organic liquid fertilizer. We've used a small amount of fertilizer with the bushes and trees, and our standard operating approach there is to feed the soil with cover crops, with adding organic matter, and then as you can see, they're just not using that fertilizer. So if someone needs some fertilizer, let me know. And then I'm gonna go right here, and underneath here is a yaupon tree. We planted it outside the anti-deer fence because they're supposed to be deer-proof. And here's comfrey. Oops. In my shadow. Here's comfrey. So we've planted comfrey around the farm. I'm continuing to plant it. And here's lantana. And we did that as a pollinator. One of the other projects is that when we built the road, we had to cut down some trees, and we've had some other trees that fell down, and we've got some debris in here we weren't really planning on. We've got a haul off. We had a pine tree that fell down recently that died. So we've got, at some point, we've got to figure out what we're going to do with this big stack of stuff. Are we going to burn it? Are we going to make another hugel mound? What are we going to do? Then here is a building that, or at least the beginnings of a building that was here. Al had started building this. One thing's happened is this winter, the tarps he used to protect it and keep it weather tight have failed. So one of our projects next week or so is to replace these tarps, get this weather tight. We have a plan of turning this into a pack house. That's our thought. The first thing is they gotta get weather tight so we preserve it. Got some work on this to do. And we're getting a bee's nest, a hornet's nest up there. So then, there again, the weed eating part is just definitely tough sometimes. So pieces of equipment we've got a box blade that I've used a good bit. We've got this turning plow, a disc one that I really don't use all that much because we try to do as much as we can not doing a lot of tillage. The only time we till is in the beginning of a bed. I've got a cultivator I don't know if I'll ever use. A single point plow, which comes in handy at times for pulling stuff out of the ground, like landscape cloth that we discovered. We have a two-point plow here, which I broke a point on yesterday, which I'll have to replace. This is handy. Definitely a different function than the box blade, the scraper blade. Single point plow. Disc. There again, if you notice, they don't have a whole lot of wear on them. I do want to get these painted. Our hay spike, that's handy. So here's our harrow, spring tooth harrow, which actually I used today. We've got a carrier here that I need to build new wood for. A bush hog. The zero turn does most of the work. The bush hog's awfully handy for the back field. The parts we're looking at now in the next field down, we couldn't do without the zero turn. That's probably the most important part here in the back field, the tractor. Once we get to where we have a little more development in the back field, we'll actually hopefully put our roller crimper to use. And then of course it's nice to be able to haul water. One of the other things is started a collection of firewood. And those of y'all that know me, I'm gonna have a hard time seeing this because here's a fire pit that's never been used. So I think that gives you an idea how busy we've been the last 2 years. So I need to use this. So speaking of that, we're gonna have a camping trip here, out here in May. So if you wanna come join us, come camp with us and we'll sit around the campfire. It's a virgin fire pit. And we've also got starting to accumulate some brush piles. And then here, we've got, you aren't gonna be able to see it on the GoPro, but we're starting to have winter squash come up. So, we've gotta do some weeding in here as well. The weeds are definitely getting a little ahead of us. We haven't hooked up, it's been so wet, we haven't needed to irrigate, so. So on the farm, one of the things we are learning to try to figure out is what to do when you need to store something. So in this case, I moved it out of the way to mow, but I've got to find a location for some of these cages and we've got to go through. And some of these were legacy from the previous owner, thanks Al. And so we put a lot of them to use and then some of them we need to just trash because they're in such bad shape. But storage is definitely an issue on the farm. All this space, but it's hard to put stuff in a way that makes sense. So you can see here, the garlic is up and going. Got some elephant garlic mixed in. One of our tasks for this weekend is to go through and weed again. It's nice growing garlic, you don't have to weed for months, and then all of a sudden, boom. We're also gonna get here to some onions. Those of you know me know that I don't grow onions well, except for this year. Look at that. Look at that down in there. I'm excited because there's a big onion down there. So I'm excited. So we've got a mixture of onions and garlic. We've been cutting these scapes to keep the onion to put the effort into the plant or the bulb, not the seeds. Here's more scapes. These are really good, kind of like a green onion. Very strong though. Some of them can get super strong. So here's our garlic and onion. Here you'll see something new this year, and that's wood chips. We've used wood chips very effectively in our home garden. So this year we're starting to use them on the farm. So these are hardwood mostly. Probably some pine in there. And these are purely pine. We got these from a company in Sanford that makes fence posts. So we're gonna try these with the potatoes. We've heard really good things about mixing the two. Of course, having a well on the property and having spigots at convenient locations has been just spectacular. We've got power here, which is handy for the well and other stuff. So here, we've got, this is eventually going to be a deck that feeds into our shed here. And so until then, we threw down clover and the clover took off. Clover is great for the bees, and the clover is great for the soil, which if we're going to put a deck over it, probably doesn't matter. So the biggest benefit we'll probably get with this is bees like it. Of course, Port-a-John is awfully handy. One of the things that we're doing is starting to, from the time the previous owner bought it to the time he sold it, one of the things that changed was this edge of bushes grew up. So when I first walked on this property several, maybe 5 or 6 years ago, you could see all the way back. So one of the things in the past few years has changed is that this edge has grown up. So we are working to fix that. It'll take a little while. Let me climb through the fence here. Anti-deer fence is wonderful. Doesn't always work. So we have cover crop planted here. You can see some things starting to come up. Cotyledons there, I believe. Some buckwheat in here. So one of the mistakes I made one afternoon, we had some pieces from a trellis. I put it all in a pile here. Didn't keep it weed-eated. So now I can't run the lawnmower through it because there's metal poles in here. So what I've got to do now is come back and weed-eat it, pull the metal poles and these pieces of wood that we were using at the time out. So that's one of those maintenance oopses. Kind of goofed up with. We've got potatoes, and honestly I'm amazed we have potatoes because it has rained 1 to 2 days a week for the past since we planted them. You can see here the ground where there was standing water for weeks. So one of our tasks for tomorrow on farm day is to do some hoeing. I'm amazed. I thought it would kill them. It was pretty bad. And it did in some places. You can see here, there's no potatoes. And we've not been able to get in here because of the weather a lot of times. So we're now losing the battle with some of the weeds. It's interesting too is that these were beds used last year and they were pretty. At the time, we kept them fairly weed-free, but you can see how some of these seeds continue because they, even after a year of keeping it weed-free, all of a sudden they just came right back. And I think that's just seeds that were previously there in the last several years. So we have sweet potato, or we have Irish potatoes, thrilled to death. A lot of native flowers here. We're trying to do more with pollinators. We've converted some of the beds that were vegetables last year to pollinator this year. You see the buckwheat coming up here. Hopefully more of it comes up. So there again, what I'm trying to do is build good soil. If I build good soil, then what we plant will do well. So we had a winter garden. We got rained out for the winter. Probably no more winter gardens here, unless we're growing pond plants. One of our other tasks is with Steve's onions. We'll get those squared away tomorrow. Another area where, see more buckwheat here coming up. Another area is where we had, we put our winter garden adjacent to our figs. Now we're starting to have to go in and weed eat all these. Here's another place where you can see damage that occurred to the fig tree. Just rough. So this fig tree is now starting to come back. So definitely have to be careful weed eating. So one of the other things we've been doing is trying to figure out how to manage hoses and weed eating and mowing. So we've been pulling out hoses. We've also used a silage tarp at times to kill some of the seeds. So this is a monster silage tarp. It's, wow, it's like 85 feet wide and 100 feet long, and it takes like 4 or 5 people to manage it. So this is one of those things. We got water that got up inside of this. And so we got in the fall, we said, okay, we're just gonna let this sit. It won't hurt anything to sit. So one of our tasks now that it's starting to get warmer is to get this pulled out somewhere so it can dry and then roll it up. I believe I'm gonna cut it in half so that it's, excuse me, it's 100 by 50. It's big. So I think I'm gonna cut it in half so I have 250 by 50 tarps just to make it easier to deal with. More figs are coming back. You can see that cold snap. They had come back alive and boom. So I think we're gonna keep most of our figs. We did have a peach tree, but I think it's a goner. We'll see. Let it sit a little while before we replace it. It was budding out. The other peach tree on the other side of the field did just fine. So our wonderful elderberries. So this farm grows elderberries. Well, maybe everybody grows elderberries well, and I just think it's me, but these have taken off. These are a year younger than the ones in the food forest, and they are doing great. Now the water table in this field is very, very high. So these two plots here have winter squash in them, and they are slow to come up. It has been cold and wet. A lot of these seeds just are not germinating well. You see a little bit of pile I gotta finish cleaning up from a tree that fell. I had a pine tree that died. And then, another thing we've got going on here is two more mulberry trees. I keep hearing people that are older tell me about these wonderful experiences they had with their mulberry trees growing up and eating the fruit and picking the fruit and putting a sheet out and catching it. We have some wildflowers which we've let grow. We'll see how that goes. So these are hazel trees. So these are two different types. We needed two different types to cross-pollinate. We want to see how the hazel trees will do. You can see here that we've put wood chips around them. Right down here, I have a lantana that I'm not sure it's going to come back. It's looking kind of eh. So we'll see. So we've left this as a, this is going to be another pollinator bed. this year is a pollinating year. We're doing a lot of soil building. And I'll talk about that in just a second, about kind of why we've made such a change from growing a lot of veggies last year. Right now, it's really quiet. There's been a lot of times where I've been working in this area and have a deer walk up this road. The other thing over this winter, we've had a lot of trees fall, so we're definitely in cleanup mode. It's right at 5 o'clock and sun's getting lower, but it's nowhere near sunset, but very quiet. So it's nice having a section of woods to enjoy. Started bush hogging in here to try to get some of this understory out. It was just too wet. I about needed another tractor to get my tractor out. So we'll come back and work on that. It's definitely peaceful watching the sun come through the trees. One thing to consider too is a tractor is tough on your where you drive it. Those cleated tires, just you see here, where it's definitely down to dirt with just a little bit of traffic. Just something to think about. If it's wet at all, your tractor is gonna be challenging. So here's the backfield. There's about 4 acres back here. I know this video has been long. I appreciate your patience. I wanted to kind of give you a state of the farm in detail. Nothing exciting. So here is a pecan tree that I don't... Oh, it's leafing out finally. We were concerned that we were going to lose it. That cold got it. The other two, but it is leafing out. So the backfield, I mentioned that needing a tractor earlier, and the tractor needed, we have to bush hog this every so often. Right now, I'm pretty content letting the grass grow until we make other changes. We've got all these wildflowers and the bees love it. So here's two other pecan trees. Again, you'll see a tag, metal tag. So these are taking off nicely. And there's another one over here. So with the pecan trees, it's important to get the cross-pollination right. So to really maximize our cross-pollination of our trees, we need one more tree. And it'll be as, for a low number of trees, as maximized as we can get. You can see the tag again. These tags are handy. Tree took some damage, but with the cold snap, but it's doing okay. So one of the things we have here is that we have a campsite. There's several places you can camp, but this is the one called in the field, in the middle of the field, literally. So you can see here in the past where actually had a campfire back here. So if you want a place that's peaceful to camp, maybe this is it. We're about 'kind of in between Raleigh and Charlotte. Like, depending on where you are in Charlotte, maybe an hour and a half from Charlotte, hour and a half from Raleigh. One of the things that I'm still learning is how to turn a field over. And I broke a point on my plow. I hit a root from that big tree over there. And I broke a point on my plow. After that, plowing just went to pieces. But anyway, So I didn't mean to throw that pun out there. So what I did today was we broadcast sunflower seeds. So there is a ring, or there hopefully will be a ring of sunflowers. We'll see. This is not how I've broken the field in the past. This was something new. And I believe there's a scale element that I still don't possess. But the plan here is for there to be some elephant ears. See the places where I've mowed out area? We're going to plant elephant ears. There's four spots. Here, here, here. And then, if all goes well, eventually we'll have sunflowers. And then as pecan trees grow, we'll have pecan trees on the other. And then we're still trying to figure out what to do with the farm. This farm is a giant experiment. It's a, think of it as a sketch, if you will, and a tractor is a pencil. So what we've got here, I've got four different plots that we're trying to convert into something that we can grow cover crops in. Start with cover crops. And so kind of thinking through the what this might look like is that I'm trying to have some flexibility as we go. So I'm thinking that this may one day be a line of trees. And then this may be natural area, or not sure yet. And then line of trees. In this back corner back here, we've started planting black walnuts. Be nice to have a pond back here in this other corner, but we'll see. So the black walnuts are growing. That's a native that does well here. So here we've got more sunflowers that have been broadcast. Like I said, I just turned this soil over yesterday. So this is going from a 30-year-old or more pasture to tilled. And it's a learning experience for me too, as you can probably see as you look at this. This could have gone a lot better, but that's okay. We'll start where we are. So this is a Sudan grass cross with sorghum. So we're trying to see how that goes. Maybe one day I'll actually use a roller crimper. And then what's going in here are cactus. So we're putting a native prickly pear cactus here. There's going to be a section here that's cactus. And those are, believe it or not, are edible. So the fruit and the leaf. So here's some of the craziness. So this has been a big lab, big experiment. I'm a mechanical engineer turned gentleman farmer. And I'm still learning. And I'm not sure where we're going to head with the farm. I'm really not. I suspect that the most likely course of action is that this is going to become an orchard. And we'll have some sort of plantings in between the trees. I guess a silvopasture, if I'm using that term correctly. And then over here, as you go up the hill, up here, our plan is to put blueberries. So we're gonna have rows of blueberries facing perpendicular to us. So like this, that's the plan. And then that way those blueberries will drain well. So one thing I did do was I put lime on this soil this fall, and probably have to do it again. Try and bring the pH up, but I left off the area where I want to plant blueberries. So we've got 20 or so blueberry plants in the Hoogel Mound, but I'd like to go and do even more. So if you decide to come out here and visit the farm, we do have farm tours. We have several events during the year. One of the events we're gonna do for the first time this year, we're calling a farm coming. The farm coming is where everybody that's helped with the farm in any way, we're inviting them to come to dinner. It's kind of a homecoming for the farm because we've had a lot of help. We couldn't have done it without you. So that's really appreciated. So we're gonna have that dinner. So you can see here, guy at work, Rob, grew these, started them for me from a walnut seed. Walnut. These are black walnuts. They've grown in the past week. 2 weeks. They've tripled in size in 2 weeks. This one was maybe 4 inches tall. Now it's 8 inches tall. Amazing. We're thinking one day it'd be nice to have a pond. And you can see here a view of where farther up this hill, we're thinking we'll put blueberries. So I appreciate you watching this video. I'm learning. This is a giant, it's a canvas. So we're trying to do several things here. One is to have a place that gets passed on. So those black walnut trees, and especially those pecan trees, you know, that pecan tree might be here 100 years from now. And so, yeah, I'm planting things that I'll never see that tree 100 feet tall, probably, but somebody might. And so there's a pass it on aspect. And then also too, we've been hoping to use this as a way to encourage people to eat healthier by giving people a place to come and participate on the farm. We'll see how that goes. We've had 2 different families that have helped us immensely on the farm, and I think enjoyed it and learned. So that's I think a huge plus. And that's something I want to do, is I want this to be a win. This really isn't a commercial farm in that sense. Yeah, we'll probably sell a few things, but that's really not the point. I mean, we want to sell enough to pay some of the expenses one day. Hopefully sooner than later. But, and then at the same time, we want to use this as a way to pay it forward. So I definitely want to pay it forward and use the farm as a way to do that. And so we can teach, we can enjoy, and kind of go from there. So if you have suggestions on what we could do differently, what we could improve, you know, am I missing something here? What? This is a huge prototype. Like I said, it's a sketch. What you're seeing is a sketch with lines on it that I put in with a tractor and put in with trees and bushes, and so on a big scale. So what do we do with this farm? Where does it go? You know, how do we benefit people? How do we help people realize that there is a way to eat healthy? And at the same time, maybe there's something that people enjoy. I definitely get a great deal out of enjoyment out of knowing that people come out here and have a good time. So as we walk back the truck, see my shadow is getting long as the sun gets lower. We're really trying to figure out what to do with this farm in terms of how do we benefit people. A friend of mine, John Burwell, really cemented my understanding of paying it forward. He helped me with projects on top of the mountain, and we both had a great time, got to be good friends. So we got way more out of it than just the end product. The journey was wonderful. So John, I thank you for that, for in some ways mentoring me in how to pay it forward better. So if you have suggestions on how to where we could go with our farm from a business model standpoint. Like I said, it's not about the money as much as it is how do we benefit people. And there's got to be a good model of how to do that. You know, we're an hour from Apex and 30 minutes from Sanford and hour and a half from Charlotte. What makes it worthwhile for people to come out here? I'm definitely interested in your thoughts. What can we do? What can we teach? What can we share? And how can we change the, I guess, change the world one family and one person at a time?